KD Bowe Show in the studio with the legendary Kurt Carr. What up, man?
How you doing? I'm scared of that word legendary. That gets you in trouble.
How you felt about that?
That gets you in trouble. I don't want Dionne Warwick coming after me.
Like she did Beyonce. Trademark?
No. She did a thing about Beyonce doing an icon, remember that. But no, I really feel,
you know that was a mess.
Yeah, I know that was. But, you know, that word legendary is thrown around a lot. But I've just been around a long time, and I pray that I've been blessing people for, all these decades.
But do you feel, despite the title, do you feel?
I think legends are old, and I feel like it's crazy because, Katie, I live in such an alternate universe. Like, I live in the suburbs, I have soccer dad hours. I go to bed at 9 o'clock. I take my godchildren to school and stuff, do crazy. So I live this really regular life. So when people are like, you're a legend, I'm like, oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, because I think they're talking about the impact.
The impact
that you have made.
And
man,
it's an honor. It's an honor. It's an honor to be recognized. Just a minute ago, we stopped at the convenience store before coming here, and this homeless man was like, oh, my God, I know you. And he was like, we lift our hands in the sand.
Wait a minute, did he?
Yeah. Like, wow. You just never know the impact that your music has on people.
Yeah. So who do you talk to when you are doing the brainstorming session? Because I think about you. I think about Donald. I think about Richard Smallwood, which I would love to have a sit down
with all three.
Like, what is that whole?
Really, it's a private thing. It's like there's an inside joke that my musicians have, that there's elves that live in my attic and they write the songs and hand them down. They're like, there go them. Every time I come with an idea, they're like, they're elves. But it has to be private. It's just me and God in my music room at my house. I have all the computers and everything, but it's just me. It starts with me and a piano.
Okay.
Me and a piano and just the ideas. And usually when I'm working on an album, I don't sleep in my bed. I sleep on the floor in my music room. It's like this time was just me and God. Oh, yeah. Yeah, like hardly any television. My friends know they're not going to talk to me on the phone for a long time. It's really a process of hearing God. And I think that's been my success and why my music is so international and multicultural, because I'm asking God to give me the sound that not only black people are going to listen to, but people around the world.
Yeah, so you don't go into the room saying, I'm going to make a hit.
No. And it's like crazy. The songs that I just throw together end up becoming hits because God said, like, the presence of the Lord is here. I wrote it in 15 minutes.
Really?
And Sanctuary wasn't even going to be on the album. We had rehearsed for 3 months, and the week of the session, so we recorded on a Saturday. On Wednesday, I said, let's warm up on this little song I started playing last night. We lift our hands in the sanctuary. We did it, and Yvette, that sings for Every Mountain, her daughter was about 5 at the time.
Yeah.
And she said the next day, Kurt, my daughter won't stop singing that song.
You knew you had something.
Because kids are honest.
Right, right.
And we recorded it, and the rest is history. So I ended up helping her go to college eventually. And, because that song changed my life. Yep.
So speaking of singers, you have a specific ear for singers. You have a knack for finding talent.
You know what? Like, Walter Hawkins.
What is that?
We went to his church a month before he died, and he said, Kurt, you have an anointing to pick singers.
Is there a math to it?
It's like a feeling I get, like, that's the one. Like, I hear people all the time. Until now, we'll talk about that later. I've never had auditions. It's just kind of been like, I'll see people and know that that's the right person for the right time. I'm a connoisseur. I love watches and singers. I like collect singers. And none of my singers sound alike. They all sound different. They are definitely the hidden treasure behind my music. They make it come to life. A great singer is nothing without a great song, and a great song is nothing without a great singer.
That's some good stuff, man.
Yeah.
You know, just watching you do what you do, you're unique, brother. So let me ask you this. It's a weird question. Where do you see yourself duplicated? Not so much that somebody is like you per se, but when you see a person, you say,
it is such an honor and an unbelievable thing, because I don't come from the church. I didn't start going to church till I was 14.
Explain
Most
that.
People are sick of church by 14. My mom was one of those women, Christian woman, but she was wounded in church.
I see.
She had my brother before she was married in the 60s, so you know that what they probably handled her. Wow. And we never discussed it, but I'm assuming that's what it was. And we actually went to church usually on Easter. That was it. And when I was 15, we moved across the street from that one church we'd go to, the Hopewell Baptist Church in Hartford, Connecticut. And when I was 15, I woke up one day and was like, Mom, I want to go to church. And I went by myself for months. And then my brother started coming, my sister started coming, and eventually my wounded mother started coming to church. So it's amazing to me now that I listen to people sing my songs around the world. I never really, I have this thing, KD, which is the truth. After I make an album, I never listen to it again, ever.
How do you remember your stuff?
Well, the thing is, usually before we record, I write for 2 years.
Oh my.
It takes me at least 2 years to write an album because I never want to write the same song over. And I say I need times to live the songs. I think that's why they touch people, because they're from unique experiences. So I write for 2 years. It takes 2 years to make an album. And the mixing process alone, I'll spend a month or two mixing. One song on this new album, I mixed 15 times. So why would I ever want to listen to it again after it's over?
It's done
and on to the next thing.
But you don't get feelings of nostalgia? I mean, you got to hear it on the radio.
And then you got to sing it for the next 20 years. So you know what I'm saying? Yeah, so yeah, it is. I heard Bless Somebody Else on the radio for the first time today, and I was like, turn it off.
Really?
I mean, it's a blessing, but it's just a thing. I gotta, I don't know.
So what song, like Vicky Winans has a song that, you know, she's like, listen, I'm good on this.
Oh, really?
Do you have a song that you like?
In the Sanctuary.
What?
When I can remember, case in point, where I wrote on a piece of paper, oh God, once again, we come into your presence.
Wait a minute, you wrote that part?
I wrote that part out in the studio. And I was like, oh God, once again. Now when we sing it, I'm like, oh God, once again. I said I was in the prophetic when I wrote that.
Oh, wow, yeah. Man. Okay, so that's everybody has that song.
Yeah.
I'm appreciative of you. You got this this single, Bless Somebody Else, Dorothy's song. Tell everybody once again who Dorothy is.
Dorothy was the woman who stood by my side for 25 years. Mm-hmm. We started together. She had got laid off her job with my sister. And my sister referred her to me to come volunteer for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
She stayed for 25 years. Wow. Walked together. She was literally my life partner. We did everything together. And she ran my life, my ministry, my recordings, everything. And a few years ago, as I was taking the stage at the Stellar Awards, she passed away of a heart attack, 50 years old. Okay. The most giving person I've ever met in my life. And when I wrote the song, Bless Somebody Else, I'm like, this is Dorothy's song. And I want to call it that to immortalize her forever. So now people will pick up the CD forever and say, who is Dorothy?
Wow.
And I'll be able to say the most Christ-like person I've ever met.
So you combined 15 artists, or was it 14?
15.
But you had one artist that was, was it one or two artists that had come on board from
it started with
a contest or whatever?
No, not on that. Not on the song, but it started with Erica Campbell.
Right.
Erica Campbell and I were personal friends when she was Erica Atkins, you know, and I asked her and her sister Tina to be in the choir when I did For Every Mountain. So if you look at the video, they're up in the choir when they used to dress like church girls.
Stop it.
She gonna kill me. They gonna kill me.
Hilarious.
And Smokey was in my group for 2 years before he did his first album. His manager asked me if I would take him on the road. He said, I got this singer from Chicago, Kurt, he's bad. And we were at West Angeles. He said, I wanted you to meet him. And this little boy came. I'm like, who is this little boy? He's shorter than me. He looked like he was 12.
Wait a minute.
It was Smokey.
Smokey is shorter than you?
Smokey's shorter than me.
I'm going to have to get a ruler. I'm going to have to verify.
He going to kill me. We're neck and neck. But yeah, he looks so young. But he opened his mouth and I was blown away.
Amazing.
And he knew Dorothy. He actually sung at Dorothy's funeral and remembered how she would write an itinerary and clip the per diem to the itinerary. And he said he used to love taking the staple out of the money. And that she was just so meticulous. She was like everybody in the group's mother. And so I asked those two to be a part of it. And then it just snowballed. Wes Morgan, Fred Hammond, Faith Evans, Yolanda Adams, John Key, Jacqueline Carr, T.D. Jakes, Kiki Wyatt, Bishop Morton,
Who's this unknown singer that I don't know who?
Oh, the one guy.
The guy.
I said Roosevelt Griffin. What happened is,
wait a minute.
This is a first.
Roosevelt ain't unknown.
No, he's not unknown. He was on Sunday Best.
Oh yeah.
He sings in my group now. He sings in my group. But what happened is about being in the right place at the right time.
Tell me about it.
Johnny Gill was supposed to do it.
Really?
Johnny Gill and I met when I did the music at Natalie Cole's funeral. When she died, it was in her will. She wanted me to do the music for her funeral because we were the best of friends. And I did it. And Johnny Gill and I met, and we've conversed since then, like every month or whatever. And I'm like, you sound like an old deacon. You need to be singing gospel.
What'd he say?
And he said, you know, his dad is a pastor. I didn't know that.
Okay.
So he's a PK. And so he was going to, because I'm blessed, help me to bless.
He
actually had the track and was recording it on a cruise. And he went on a cruise and he got off on Honduras and they stopped him at customs and detained him for days. He thought he was going to jail in Honduras. And it was nothing illegal. It was just he had more cash in his pocket than he was supposed to have. And the government there is crooked. And we had to turn the song in. So Roosevelt happened to be in the studio. I'm like, well, come on, brother, go to the mic. And that's how it happened.
That's a truly gifted guy right there, man. So Bless Somebody Else is a song that is an homage to Dorothy. And the artwork on the project.
Yeah.
That's it's becoming
legendary. I did it with the great Derek Blanks from here in Atlanta. He's a great. I told him it's an insult to call his work pictures. It's art.
That's good.
And I chose him because I kind of have an artistic background and I've studied art and I could tell that he was more than a photographer. He actually has a degree in art.
Mm.
So we did an album cover. It's called an alter ego picture. It's like me blessing myself and blessing a homeless person. Mm. And it took hours and hours to do, but I think when you see it, it kind of just really summarizes what that song "Bless Somebody Else" is about.
No, brother, it's definitely amazing. Yeah. A couple more things, man, before I let you get out of here. You've met a lot of people. That your Elton John story is one of
Barry Manilow.
I'm sorry, let me fix that.
Barry
Manilow story.
Yeah, I've never met Elton John. I want to though. He can play the piano.
You ever been to one of his concerts?
Never.
Listen.
And I am an Elton John. Some people say I remind him of Elton John. I don't know what that's about. But anyway,
he
can play the piano. Gladys and Aretha told me, said that little white boy could play the piano.
So, okay, I'm going to get to Aretha
play,
in a minute.
He plays like gospel. And I can't explain. Dun, dun, dun. Something about the way you look tonight. That sounds like a gospel song.
Yeah,
take my breath away. Hallelujah.
Right.
You know, that sounds like a church song. And he's so church-based, I think. He studied gospel.
So take me to Barry Manilow. When you met him, you walked up on him, you were introducing yourself to him like, hey, man. He was like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
I know you, but he did something different.
Yeah, what happened is I was going to his concert because – to me, he's the king of the song.
Mm.
He writes the songs that make, I mean, song after song after song. And most people you hear sing have not written the songs, but he writes them. He's a writer's writer. And I don't have a lot of his records, but out of respect for him, I went to see him because the theater was near my house and went not knowing him or anything. And I texted one of my friends and said, I'm going to see Barry Manilow. He said, his background singer is my friend. The background singer played one of my tracks, Holy, 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 an arrangement I did years ago for Barry Manilow, and he bowed at my feet when he met me.
Wow.
He bowed to me, yeah. So
that's crazy.
It was on, because he loves melodies and he loves music, and I told him how a lot of my ballads that have more of a pop feeling, I studied his techniques and modulations and stuff.
What did Aretha Franklin say about you?
Well, Aretha... I had the opportunity to play for her when I was music director for James Cleveland. And the day I was going to go out with her, she got sick and the gig got canceled.
Wow.
So I never went. I never got to play for her. Fast forward years later, I was in Detroit and we were doing a concert and I didn't know she was in the audience. And I lost it. I was like, where is Aretha Franklin?
You got nervous?
Oh my God, I was, Aretha Franklin, where is she? And we were singing, he kept me, God kept me. And I'm like, would you, and I handed her the mic.
You handed the mic to Aretha Franklin?
Oh, yes, he did. Oh, Lord.
And she was cool with
she
it.
She killed it. murdered. And there's a picture of me. I'll text it to you. Like, I'm just, like, laying in her lap. Like,
oh.
And we became friends after that. And we actually went to sing for her a couple of times. And she, I don't know if she didn't know my name, but she just called me Sanctuary every time I was
there.
Every time I saw her, she would say, or she would call me, she'd be like, Sanctuary.
Now, did you have the air off when she was there that
oh
day?
Oh, my God. Yeah, visiting her in her dressing room, it was like boiling hot.
Everybody,
she did a concert. She no air. If the air is on, it takes her voice. She can sing all night when it's hot. So, you know, wow. White people like air. So we were in the dressing room, and Clive Davis and David Foster, they were all like, because it was so hot.
Every video we've seen of Aretha,
it's hot. She's sweating.
She's sweating.
That's why.
And I never knew what
that
was.
That's why. Tremaine is the same way. Having worked with her, you know, I produced the song I Never Lost My Praise
indeed,
for her.
Indeed.
And Tremaine, I because she was up in age, I hadn't heard her in years. I'm like, can she still sing? I didn't know. Man, she opened up her mouth. She sounds exactly the same. She didn't even drop the key a half step.
Mm.
Same thing. She can sing all night long when she's sweating, but any air just takes her voice away. So. Yeah.
So you got the secrets and the behind the scenes of all these.
I'm actually writing a book, man, because I feel like I was at the changing of the guard. Like,
tell me what that
because
means.
I was 21 years old playing piano for James Cleveland. I was his music director. We went on tour from Florida to New York in a van.
Florida to New York in a van.
In a van. Florida, drive 800 miles, concert. 600 miles, concert. 400, edged all the way up to the East Coast, and then would go from there to Detroit. And everyone would take a turn driving, and he was like, James Cleveland was like, per diem, what's that, a Greek word? What is that? I'm paying you to sing, not to eat.
Wow.
You know, we did per diem and first class and all that. We didn't have any of that. But I say I watched the changing of the guard because after he passed away, I joined forces with Vicky Mack Latia that started Gospel Centric,
sure,
that got the cassette. I was there when she had a cassette of Kirk Franklin, who wrote a song called The Reason Why I Sing. And she, there were two songs, that and Silver and Gold. And she wanted me to listen to it to hear what I thought. I love Silver and Gold more. And a year later, he was a superstar. And I watched us go from driving in vans to flying first class and having television shows and the appearance, the commercial success that we have now.
Were you resistant to any of it? I mean, it was better. It was an upgrade, but were you resistant at all to it? Because
no.
Sometimes we get married to the
church
method.
Church people in particular, yeah, we don't like to move. But, I mean, it was.
But we do get married to the method.
Yeah.
It was how, I mean, I know
how
a preacher who
done.
Would never wear a different color shirt than a white one. Because his best, greatest moment in preaching, he had a white shirt on.
Yeah.
So he would never stripe one. It was always white.
I was blessed to have KD, especially since my mom was not a church woman. She was not. My mom was a beautiful person, but we never had family prayer. She never laid her hands on. I've never seen my mother read me a scripture. But God knew, and he put people strategically in my life. The first person I needed to meet was James Cleveland because I didn't know hymns. I didn't know the songs of the church. I learned that from him. And then I got involved with West Angeles Church of God in Christ. Which,
what was it about? I want to interrupt you. But what was it about James Cleveland that made you say, that was the thing?
You know, Bishop Jake says, you don't have to chase favor, it finds you.
Mm.
I was at the GMWA. I had a group called the Kurt Carr Singers back on the East Coast. And we had sung 3 years at the GMWA. And every year we sang, he wasn't in the room for some reason. And one year it was in New York, which is next door to Connecticut. It was an hour and a half drive.
Sure.
Didn't bring the group, didn't sing at all. I'm having lunch with a guy named Mr. Clean, Richard White, who lives here in Atlanta.
Right.
And we were eating barbecue chicken at across the street from Madison Square Garden, and James Cleveland walked in and sat at the table. And Clean was like, "Have you heard this boy play?" I almost said this. You know, Clean, how he is. Clean was like, "Have you heard this boy? This boy is phenomenal. He's studying music. He just graduated from music school." Da 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 da. And I didn't know that James Cleveland's music director, a guy named Calvin Bernard Roan, had just tenured his resignation because he was pastoring a church and the church was growing and he couldn't play for Reverend Cleveland anymore.
Yeah.
So I didn't know he was looking for a keyboard player at the time. And he heard me play, and that was in August. And I was like, well, I'm still under contract at a church until January. And if the job is still open in January, and I moved in January 1st and started playing with him. So he's the connection that I need. That's how I got with him. Then West Angeles was the church that I, even though I was playing at James Cleveland's church, I felt like I needed a church home to be fed.
Right.
I would go to West Angeles early and then go play for James. So I learned praise and worship at West Angeles.
Wow.
And then eventually I got to meet Andre Crouch.
Well, I mean, you was there during the whole Saints and Praise.
So I
did I hear you on any of that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. But I wasn't an artist then. I was playing. So I wouldn't have been in the forefront. Yeah, my name's on some of those albums. And then I met Andre Crouch, which really kind of sealed what I needed.
Okay.
I had the tradition from James, the praise and worship from West Angeles, but then I needed the multicultural from Andre Crouch. Because his music, he's sung in 80 countries.
Hmm.
Yeah, so.
All right, so final thing, man, and I could talk with you for a long time, but this is a tough question that I'm going to ask you.
Okay.
Because I just believe that the essence or the greatness of a man is his legacy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And I'm curious about, who is your Elijah?
Hmm.
Who is the person that you are?
Yeah. I think, I have two millennials. I have this thing that I did this year, a millennial search, where I wanted, because Katie, like, In the Sanctuary is kind of like a Barney song. Like, little kids love that song.
Yeah.
And, like, in my concerts, I have a thing where kids come up. And in the last few years, I've noticed the little babies don't know it. Because the song is like 20 years old. The song is like 20 years old.
So, church,
but I'm just saying, but the babies don't know it like they used to. So I said, I got to do something to continue to. I can't be an artist that I'm not. I'm not trying to be Kirk Franklin. He does a great job at what he does. And we're both named Kirk because my real name is Kirk Douglas.
Oh, wait a minute.
But my mom spelled it wrong because my real name is Kirk Douglas. After the actor, and it's K-I-R-K.
Shut up.
And she said, the nurse brought back the thing and said, oh, you spelled it wrong. It's supposed to be K-I-R-K. And she gave her the change form. She said, I'll just leave it. Because God knew there was going to be two short Kirks. So, you know, I don't covet doing what he does. So I can't do that. I got to do me. But I try to figure a way to get a younger audience. So I selected two millennials. This girl named Tia Askia, who is a beast.
Tia
Askia. I thought she was African, but that's just her name. And a guy named Travis Taylor. He's from New Jersey. She's from D.C. And once you hear them, they're unbelievable.
And I'm mentoring them.
And the thing, now you can be famous with YouTube overnight, but you're not prepared to be an artist.
Okay.
There's been no development. You can sing, but you're not an artist.
So what's the hardest part about doing that for them? I mean, they're young, so.
But now with YouTube, you can be famous overnight and no one mentors you and guides you and teaches you how to do interviews and teaches you how to carry yourself and teaches you how your personal life has to mirror your ministry life
but
and stuff like that.
People don't, even record companies, they don't care. That's why the A&R department is no longer in existence.
Yeah, but that's why the artists are, unfortunately.
And people want your gift, but they don't necessarily care so much.
You know what, I have a thing that I say to my singers. People respect your gift, but who respects you? Mm-hmm. They'll call you to sing, but how many of the pastors gave you their number?
And then there's that. And then there's that.
And I thank God that I had mentors, that like a Bishop Charles Blake, who's one of the most integral people I've ever met, that taught me that integrity is important. If you say you're going to be somewhere at 9 o'clock, don't come at 9:30. You know, and things, small things like that, that make you be an artist. So I believe that the legacy I'm leaving is to them, but also my songs are my legacy. That's why I don't do albums every year.
Okay.
It's because I got to live these songs and craft them in a way that they will, a lot of my songs are becoming called classics. And that doesn't just happen overnight. And it's not coincidence.
How does it make you feel when you hear the song, the word classic?
Classic. Honored.
Okay.
Honored. And you know what? And the last thing I'll say, I was actually at Andre Crouch's deathbed when he died because he was like, we just hit it off like that.
Oh, I remember this. Please
and,
say this.
And
say
he, Sandra was with us, his twin, and She left the room and he squeezed my hand because he didn't want to say it in front of her. He said, Kurt, I am dying. I'm going home to be with God. He said, you have to keep the name Jesus in your music. The thing I respect, he never sold out. I look back, he was like on the Jeffersons.
Contrary to popular belief.
He never sold out.
Wow.
The thing about him that in having worked with him, he would minister to like somebody sweeping the floor. He wasn't even, do you know Jesus? He was an evangelist. He was the kind of guy that, even though his music was very contemporary and ahead of his time, but his heartbeat was about ministering. And he made me promise to keep Jesus in the music. And he said, Jesus is the trend that will never go out of style. If you write about Jesus, your songs will live forever. That's the last thing he said to me. And the next day he was dead.
Yep. Blessings to you, man. You are a gift to the body. You don't need to be or attempt to be anybody other than what you are, because what you are is enough and is necessary.
Man, thanks for your support and everyone listening, everybody watching.
Hope you hear me on that.
I appreciate you. Yeah.
Hear me?
Yes, I do.
You are necessary. It's a lot of stuff that's out here, man, that all these trends and what have you. Oh, it's a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
But because of who you are, you have listeners that are crying.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you don't have too many cry songs, sir. But these are songs. You make songs for the soul. Yeah. And I appreciate you. Our listeners appreciate you.
Thank you.
Much success to you, man.
I appreciate it.
Indeed. Thank you. Kurt Carr, ladies and gentlemen. KD Bowe Show.